It's time for Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness, powered by the staff at Race Chaser Online. Today's racing news, yesterday's racing history, and now here are your hosts, Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
Welcome to Motorsports Madness on a Monday night on the Performance Motorsports Network. My name is Tom Baker from RaceChaserOnline.com, along with three of my colleagues from Race Chaser. Jacob Seelman off tonight, but we have with us Marshall Gabell, we have James Pike, and we have Kyle Magda, all of us from Race Chaser Online, and we are getting set to talk a couple of hours of motorsports with you. And gosh, guys, where do we start after a busy weekend? Let's start with the long 12-hour endurance race at Bristol. And let's start with you, Marshall Gabell. Bristol Motor Speedway held the longest NASCAR Sprint Cup race of the season yesterday and last night. And when it was all said and done, a familiar face at Victory Lane, Matt Kenseth, suddenly looking like a championship contender. Or is he?
Well, you know, that's obviously a long way to go to the season. It all comes down to that final race at Homestead. But how about Bristol? Three red flags, including a four-hour break. We got 22 laps in to start the event and then had to hit the long, almost stretching for over close to the five-hour mark. And rainstorms persistent throughout the afternoon. And then eventually, somehow, some way, we got Matt Kenseth into Victory Lane to end a 51-race winless drought. But what an incredible race to finish. But it took a lot of jet-drying air titans and some pretty courageous drivers to finally end up in Victory Lane, Tom.
Yeah, it was definitely a very long day, and we'll talk about the ending to the race, too, because I know we're probably going to have some back and forth about that. We'll get to that in just a moment. Let's turn to the other side of the round table, and let's talk to Kyle Magda. And Kyle, okay, so Matt Kenseth won the race, but he's surely the only contender through the day. I think a lot of people are going to be the day Kurt Busch finally does it, and then Kurt Busch did something. But it had nothing to do with winning the race.
Yeah, I don't think that was really the best call there, pitting when everybody else stayed out. With how much track position means at a track like Bristol, you can't really do that in that situation. But another guy I saw, I know Marshall picked him, was Carl Edwards. He ran right up there toward the front. Just kind of didn't get the break on the restart there toward the end and got in a little brush up with Kurt there in the end. But yeah, just so many names, big names got out of the race yesterday. Brad Keselowski, Joey Logano, Kevin Harvick. There were so many big-time names. Martin Truex Jr. to another marshal. That race just, it seemed like whoever was leading, it seemed like it just, they could not keep it except for Matt Kenseth there, Marshall, who won in the end.
Yeah, there was so many incidents during the race that took out top competitors. I mean, we had Kevin Harvick, the defending champion, end up involved in a crash. Not at his own doing, but still involved. We had both Penske teammates involved, Carl Edwards, like you mentioned. It eventually came down to who could just survive, pretty much, and that ended up being the number 20 of Matt Kenseth, James. But let's hit on the point about Team Penske, because it took 22 laps for both of their cars to end back in the garage area without even a chance at getting past the rainstorms, much less the anywhere pretty much in the race, ended up way down the scoreboard. Not the way that Team Penske wanted to have their day in Thunder Valley, James.
Yeah, you know, I thought it was very interesting that when I thought back on the way the race played out last night, I began to realize, wow, Keselowski and Logano really did wreck at the beginning of this thing, even though it felt like ages and ages and eternities ago compared to the end of the race last night. But yeah, I think a little bit unfortunate the way that played out, and a little bit unfortunate, especially since I suspect that just about everybody in the building knew that Keselowski and Logano probably would have had something to say in the end of the race if they had the chance to be there. But on the flip side, while all of these guys who have run really well up to the start of the season were able to go out and get wrecked some way, somehow, you know, Tom, we have a Toyota in Victory Lane for the first time this season. We had Carl Edwards and Matt Kenseth both put in their best performances of the year by far. And, you know, not that the Toyotas have looked all that strong, but maybe this is the kind of thing they need to start picking up momentum going into this run here of Richmond and Talladega and the big weeks of Charlotte, perhaps?
Well, Denny Hamlin got a win in Martinsville as well, so there's that for the Toyota camp. And what was interesting to me, and I want to go back to Kurt Busch for a moment, is when we were talking about contenders for this weekend's race on last week's shows, I don't think any of us really – I think we discussed Kurt. I don't think any of us would have put Kurt in our top three or four that we would have thought might have a shot at this. And – he just literally came out of nowhere and was having a great race, and then he spun all by himself and fortunately didn't take anybody with him. But then he recovered from that, came blasting back through the field, looked like he was in position again, Marshall, to possibly take a win, and then the pit stop thing happened. But I got to tell you, looking at what I saw yesterday, Kevin Harvick up front till he was taken out, Kurt Busch up front. Tony Stewart actually had a better run for himself in the 14 car. And even Danica Patrick had another solid run for her for a bit of the race. Stewart Haas looked pretty doggone sporty at Bristol.
They absolutely didn't. Did we expect anything less? I mean, just a few weeks ago at the Martinsville short track, we saw Harvick contend, ended up, I believe, eighth, and then, of course, Danica with the seventh place run at Martinsville. I think Stewart Haas has set themselves up for success on these short tracks. Even the mile track at Phoenix, Kevin Harvick was able to grab the victory there. And you talk about Harvick and Busch being so strong for Stewart Haas, and in fact, they weren't even the highest finishers. I think that might be the first time that those two haven't been upside in the top 10. It was actually Danica with the ninth place finish and Tony with a sixth place effort to result the highest finishes for Stewart Haas this weekend at Bristol. Obviously, Harvick being involved in the crash and Kurt having his struggles. Kurt didn't even have his regular crew chief atop the box. Of course, Tony Gibson suffering with kidney stones. He did pass it, however. He did get to pass it this morning, he said, and he will be back at Richmond, Tom.
Yeah, but the key was, Marshall, is who replaced him on the pit box. You had a pair of guys, but I would suspect that the main signal caller was Greg Zipidelli.
Yeah. Greg obviously had control.
He hasn't been on, and I think his name was Johnny Klausmeier. I didn't take that note, but I think the engineer or the car chief was the other kind of co-crew chief, but I think Greg pretty much had control. And how amazing would that have been if Kurt would have snuck up and won that race and Zippy goes to victory lane, not even knowing he was going to crew chief? And actually, that whole scenario, that's what was strange. During the long rain delay that we had, that scenario changed completely because Tony Gibson started the race on the box, and then during the rain delay, he had some sort of issue with the kidney stone and had to be relieved of his duties. And while that was going on, Denny Hamlin had something happen with the neck or the upper back area and had to come out of the car, and they had time to actually call Charlotte and get Eric Jones on a plane to Bristol, get him ready to go and in the car by the time they came back from the rain delay. And Eric Jones took over the 11. And I got to tell you, for somebody who obviously did not fit the car as it was, steering wheel was way too close. I've done some racing. I can imagine what that does to your physical energy when you can't be relaxed on the wheel. But my goodness gracious, Marshall, that was an effort by Eric Jones just to get through that race in one piece, and I thought he did a good job.
He absolutely did a good job. I mean, you can't expect anything else from a rookie driver getting called up at 4:30 p.m. during a rain delay and getting called out to Bristol to come jump, obviously under unfortunate circumstances, but it wasn't a stellar performance, but certainly a successful one to jump in the car so soon, come out, get a 26th place finish. And the one thing that I noticed throughout the race is he progressively got better. He avoided the mayhem, which is so key at Bristol. He just logged laps, had no controversy. You never really heard him in the headlines of a crash or anything like that, Kyle, but it was successful for Eric. I mean, he got the pole in the Xfinity Series, and it turns out a great weekend for him as he gets to make a partial Sprint Cup Series debut.
He was about to take a nap, too, when he got the phone call, so yeah, kind of going there in a pinch a little bit. But guys, we saw a lot of strange things yesterday. Something I thought was strange was so many good drivers spitting out in that race, just losing out of control, not even getting any contact. Brad Keselowski, Kevin Harvick, Carl Edwards, all guys that have won in some series in that track. And it's just crazy that so many cars got torn up. But a guy we were talking about earlier, underdogs like Justin Allgaier, he was running fifth at one point in that race, and he does have an Xfinity Series win there back in 2010. So just so many great stories without the night. You know, Kyle Larson coming back, having to pit under green, coming back to finish, I want to say 7th or 8th. I know the running order was kind of changed up there a little bit, but just so many great stories coming out of Bristol. And Ricky Stenhouse Jr. Finishing 4th in that race as well, and is in his second straight top 5 in the Bristol Spring Race.
Yeah, that was a good run for Stenhouse. And I think, you know, really the first time that any of the Roush cars have looked ultra competitive. And even then, it was later in the race before, although Biffle made an early track position move, Marshall. And, you know, this was maybe just a little bit of a hope, Marshall.
I don't know if it was a little bit of a hope. I think this is a big momentum shift for Roush Fenway, and specifically the number 17 squad. While historically Bristol has always been Ricky Stenhouse's best track, considering that's where all of his top 10, top 5 finishes have came at, except for one at Talladega, I think that this will be huge for a team heading into Richmond next weekend. It's just, that's a track that Carl Edwards performed well at in his tenure at Roush, Tom, but Bristol was certainly great for underdogs and great for a lot of teams, including Matt Kenseth.
Yeah, we'll talk, we'll continue talking about some of the other dogs and some of the other highlights of the Cup race and thoughts, and we'll hit the Xfinity Series race as well. Around the turn, you are listening to Motorsports Madness on a Monday night on the Performance Motorsports Network.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250 capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast karting center.
In the race of everyday life, it's nice to have the green flag. But drivetrain problems are the pits. A fully remanufactured engine, transmission, or differential from Jasper Engines and Transmissions costs less than a new vehicle and comes with a 3-year, 100,000-mile nationwide transferable warranty. See jasperengines.com for details and get the green flag in your race of everyday life.
See the boys at Chandler & Sons Automotive, 45977 Old Ox Road in Sterling. Give them a call, 703-437-7300.
Ever hire, never quit. Lofty goals in this age of shoddy quality, corporate indifference, and built-in obsolescence. It's a beacon of light in a crowded field of mediocrity. The way a company is run is an indication of how you, the customer, is going to be treated. You have a lot of choices when you're searching for auto and performance parts online and at the corner parts store. So why should you buy from Excelsior Racing? Because they're simply the best online parts supplier in the business. If you're looking for selection, ease of ordering, cost, and prompt delivery, look no further. If you have a question, our customer service hotline, staffed by knowledgeable gearheads like you, will ensure that you get what you need to fix or mod your car or truck. With 1,000 suppliers, you're guaranteed to get what you need, first time, every time. Excelsior Racing, excellence on the track, excellence on the road, excellence in customer service. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs.
From IamSecond.com.
Well, when I got to 17, I was playing in after-hours bars, just in a bunch of trouble.
Grammy Award winner Michael W. Smith.
Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there, it was LSD, and your compass sort of just like disappeared. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out. I was very depressed. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was just weeping. I was weeping. And I just began to just cry out for God. 12:30 at night, on the linoleum floor of my kitchen, the God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor. I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. I'm a son of the High King of the universe.
Watch Michael's story at IamSecond.com.
Hi, this is Tommy Barrett, driver of the NASCAR Wheel and Modified Tour. Now back to more race talk from the Speed 77 radio crew on the Performance Motorsports Network.
Welcome back to tonight's Motorsports Madness here on Performance Motorsports Network. Tom Baker, along with Marshall Gabell, James Pike, and Kyle Magda, all of us from RaceChaserOnline.com, where you want to check throughout the day each day for today's racing news. And, of course, we always have yesterday's racing history, lots of unique content and audio, all kinds of good stuff going up on a daily basis at Race Chaser. We have a great time with it. We are thankful to be a part of the Performance Motorsports Network as well as we continue talking motorsports here still on the subject of Bristol Motor Speedway and specifically the Sprint Cup race from yesterday and last night. And Marshall, I want to come back to you for this because not only did some drivers have some fantastic runs yesterday, we talked about some of the underdogs that stood out in that race throughout the event, but we also had some top 10 streaks come to an end. It was a very fickle race at Bristol yesterday.
Oh, it absolutely was. When do you see Joey Logano 40th, Kevin Harvick 38th, and then, of course, Martin Truex Jr., who's opened the season so strong, finishing 29th. All those drivers 29th or worse in Bristol, and that should just show the competitive nature. And also, anything's bound to go down in Thunder Valley at the last great Coliseum. It's just such a hard race to manufacture. You have 500 laps at such a demanding track. To be able to survive all of them is a task in itself, much less avoid all contact, and that's exactly what these three couldn't do, whether it was their fault or not. They just found themselves in the wrong spot at the wrong time, and the top 10 streaks are over to begin the 2015 season, which means we all get to get back to a little bit of sanity here. And but I surely expect, going back to Richmond, a track that Harvick's had success at, Logano's been strong at, he won there last season, I expect them, all three of them, to be right back on track and continue to pick right up where they left off with some more top 10 finishes.
James Pike, would you possibly, when this race started, would you possibly have thought that all of those guys would have been outside the top 10 at the end? I'm not sure. I would have thought one of them would have been outside the top 10 at the end, let alone all three.
Maybe once in a blue moon, I'd say. And I don't remember having any blue moons come about recently. So it was, I guess, shocking. And at the same time, as Marshall said a little bit earlier, sobering too, because you recognize that these drivers aren't necessarily superhuman. And, you know, every once in a while they have an off day, contrary to popular belief. But I'm also with Marshall, and I'm definitely of the opinion that we're going to go to Richmond and we're going to see those three probably play a significant and large role in determining who wins that race, Tom.
It's definitely going to be interesting. That I will talk about Richmond as we get toward the end of the show. If we have some time, we'll look ahead and, of course, have our picks. But I think Richmond is shaping up to be a very interesting race, and I don't expect any of those three guys to be remaining outside the top 10 for very long. Interesting week this week, too, by the way, just to throw this in, the Denny Hamlin Showdown event for the late models coming up this Thursday night, and just found out today that is going to be tape delayed and rebroadcast on NBC Sports Network. So that should be fun, and we'll look forward to that as well. As we continue to think about what happened at Bristol, I'm kind of looking at this race overall, and I'm asking myself the magic question: did NASCAR make the right call or the wrong call by going back to green flag and actually going ahead with the green white checkered. Now, I'm quite sure that we're all going to have an opinion on this. I'm going to start with mine and I'm going to vote yes. I'm buying it. It's the right thing to do. They had the opportunity. All of us have been complaining, or a lot of us, that they keep ending under caution. This was a race that was setting up to be an unbelievable finish. It really never happened, but I 100% agree with the decision. I think it was good that they did it. I was glad it ran off like clockwork. Marshall Gabell, I'm coming to you. Are you buying this, or are you selling it?
Oh, I'm definitely buying it. I mean, fans have sat in those grandstands last night from when the race originally was supposed to start at 1 p.m. Eastern. They had to see the finish. They had to see that checkered flag drop. There was no way with two laps to go that a simple pop-up shower was going to end their night and leave them going home saying if and if. The only thing that I didn't like about this, Kyle, is that NASCAR ran him around on the track too long before throwing the red flag, and it eventually cost Austin Dillon. The fuel cell went dry, and it cost him a solid finish, a top five finish where he was running. That's the only problem that I saw with it, but overall, NASCAR made the right decision by keeping the cars and letting them finish under the checkered flag.
Yeah, and since we're talking about Thunder Valley, it's thundering outside right now here. But, yeah, I mean, when that first happened with Austin Dillon, with them running under the caution, the first thing that I thought of was last year's race. You know, the whole caution light malfunction thing. And then NASCAR ending the race at 500 laps and throwing the checkered flag. So first kind of just said, kind of threw me off a little bit, got me a little confused, you know, not doing it last year, but doing it this year. But I absolutely agree with you guys with running the race. I mean, I didn't know how long that shower was going to be, because same thing with last year. So I don't know what was going to happen, but I do not agree that NASCAR should have ran that long under the caution, because they were talking about fuel. Of course, like you said, Marshall, Austin Dillon ran out of gas. And, you know, with same thing with Matt Kenseth and Jeff Gordon, they were getting close on fuel there. And I know for a while there, it was going to be almost close to a fuel game. You know, we get a couple green-white checkers and run overtime like we did last night.
Okay, so Kyle Magda, are you selling the idea that they were running so long under the caution, which I think we'd all agree with, they took way too many caution laps. I want to know if you're buying or selling that they actually went back to the green-white checkered instead of just stopping the race where it was.
Oh, no, I'm buying it for sure. Okay. I mean, because when you look at the two situations, like I said, 2014, like it depends how long the shower was last night. I mean, I didn't know it just popped up out of nowhere and just lasted for a brief amount of time. It's just I was thinking back to last year. I just didn't really know why they didn't do it last year and do it this year. But no, I'm all for it. I mean, you know, the fans deserve to see a good race, especially waiting all that time during the entire day.
Okay, James Pike, you're last to weigh in here. Are you buying or selling the green-white checkered finish after running so long under the caution?
If you want me to be really honest about it, I think my answer to that would probably be meh, maybe a very slight buy, if only for the principle of finishing under green, which is something that you guys have already hit on, that everybody wants to try and see a race finish under green if it can be done. However, there are two things that jump out at me when I think back at the finish of last night. One, that it was raining relatively hard when we finally did wrap things up. And B, there are some tracks out there where if you have a green-white checkered, it can actually significantly alter the finishing order of a race. Talladega would probably be the best example of that. You know, California would be another good example too. But Bristol is so narrow and it's so tough to pass that even a green-white checkered, I don't think, really would have done that much. And I'm fairly certain that regardless, Matt Kenseth would still be winning this race. I had a feeling that once we got down to about 10 to go and we just started seeing caution after caution after caution, that he probably had this bagged up unless he got punted from behind and we had something a la Earnhardt on Terry Labonte in the 99, I guess, summer race here, where Labonte got put in on the last lap. It would have taken something like that, I think, for him to not lose this race, because it's just hard to get around somebody in Bristol, period, Tom.
Okay, yeah, and I'll agree with that. I think we're all in agreement that it was good that they went back to green, finished it under the green for the fans' benefit. And also, I have the feeling this is where you're going, Marshall. This race was in honor of Steve Burns, and I think it was only appropriate that as much as Steve is fighting as hard as he can and not giving up, NASCAR fought as hard as they could, and they didn't give up.
They absolutely didn't give up, which was really cool to see all those pit crew members at the beginning of the race holding up I Stand for Steve signs. That was really humble to see. But one last point about the whole rain issue, that last little spot-up shower, after the checkered flag flew, Fox went off of their coverage, a huge rainstorm came down on Bristol, and that would be a little... a weird situation, I would say, for fans trying to leave the racetrack, because it was really thunderstorming after the checkered flag wave, Tom. But one race that didn't see any rainstorms, and it didn't see any controversy either. It went clean to the finish. That was Joey Logano in the NASCAR Xfinity Series race on Saturday. He dominated wire to wire in the number 22, and Kyle, just a dominating performance.
Yeah, it was a good weekend for me fantasy-wise, winning both the Xfinity and Cup races, but that's not the point. But with Joey Logano, I mean, first time a driver's led wire-to-wire in that series since Kyle Busch at Richmond last year. But I do want to give a shout-out to a couple guys. Daniel Suarez, we've been running the full-time Xfinity series this season, finishing second in that race, really showing some muscle there. And Chris Buescher as well, getting a top five. I mean, Chris Buescher... For everything we've said about Roush, Tom, this year in a Cup series, Chris Buescher has been running running great in that series, and I think he's going to get another win here, another career win here pretty soon.
Oh, yeah, no question. I mean, Chris, he's done a great job in both series this year, the Xfinity series, of course, and also the Cup series filling in the front row motorsports car, and has really looked very, very well. So definitely excited about that. Now, let me take a moment here to read the lap leader chart for the Xfinity race on Saturday. Lap one, Joey Logano, all the way to 300. There, that's done. Unbelievable. How do you lead 300 out of 300 laps? You cannot possibly dominate like that, except Joey Logano did. And I wonder if Ryan Blaney now, who swapped races with Joey before the weekend, said, I want the fall race, you can have the spring race. I wonder if he's just wishing maybe he might have gotten back in that race car and tried to make it his last two starts in Bristol. He won the fall race last year. That's why he decided to swap races and Jolo took over the car. And I'm sure Joey's thanking Ryan right now. Hope he buys him a juicy steak for that. With that, we are going to step aside for a moment. When we come back, swapping things over, we're going to talk some open wheel. Joel Sebastianelli going to join us, the Mazda Road to Indy TV co-host, and we're going to talk IndyCar, Indy Lights, and F1 right on the other side. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com, enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest. At WinYourNewCar.com, complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cottman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cottman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cottman and let your local Cottman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cottman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cottman, real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cottman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cottman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
Media sales professionals with agency experience. If you're frustrated with your current position, unrealistic quotas, and inept management,
If you're a sales machine and you simply will not take no as an acceptable reply. If you're looking for a rapidly growing company with unlimited sales potential for commissions in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. If you're searching for a high-tech, forward-looking, laid-back, but extremely professional organization who appreciate your skills and dedication, we have your next opportunity. Scorpion Radio Group is building a sales team of self-starters who are motivated. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444 or email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. That's 717-749-0444 and ask for Sue.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250 capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast Karting Center.
For 17 years, Stock Car Steel has been a leading material supplier to the racing industry. Now they're also an official motorsports content partner of Race Chaser Online. The biggest names in NASCAR trust Stock Car Steel for all their raw materials, such as carbon steel, chrome moly, DOM, aluminum, plastics, and much, much more. You can't build a race car without the basic materials, and Stock Car Steel is the place to get them. Don't forget to also visit Stock Car Steel's sister company, SRI Supplies, for racing and industry. SRI is your number one source for all your shop supply needs. Nuts, bolts, rivets, tapes, adhesives, cutting tools, chemicals, body shop supplies, paint shop supplies, lubricants, and more. A well-stocked race shop is a winning race shop, and the road to winning begins with three letters, SRI. For more information, visit StockCarSteel.com and SRI-Supplies.com. You can also find them on Facebook at Stock Car Steel and Aluminum, or call either company toll free at 1-888-752-7272.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
Back to Motorsports Madness on a Monday night here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Marshall Gabel, Kyle Magda, and joining us online is our resident wine and cheeser, who now, of course, is part of the hosting team of Mazda Road to Indy TV's online show coverage. Joel Sebastianelli is with us. And Joel, I got to imagine that we'll start right off with that. I got to imagine that being up in the booth with the NBC Sports Network crew was a real thrill for you, and just being selfish for a moment on our behalf here, we're all really proud of you and the job that you did yesterday, and we're just excited about everything that you got going this year on that side of things.
Well, I mean, don't overhype it. It was a few minutes just to pitch Mazda Road to Indy TV, give everybody a chance to be alert about the fact that you can download the timing and scoring app with live audio, stuff from the TV show. But it was still definitely very neat to be up there. Great to talk to Kevin Lee and Anders Krohn. Anders is actually a fantastic guy. A lot of great talking points. Had an awesome time with him over the weekend. So it was a really cool deal. And as far as Long Beach is, I don't think there's any better atmosphere for a street course race in this country than Long Beach. Everything from the history to the fans. We're talking 200,000 fans in a three-day span. It's really such a cool event. It was special to be a part of in any capacity.
Well, I got to tell you, you were all weekend there, and we'll get to the Indy Lights race in a moment. Let's talk about the IndyCar race from yesterday, because we've spent an awful lot of time in the show talking about how Penske has been pretty much dominant this year. But boy, yesterday, Scott Dixon surely made a statement that that was going to come to a rapid fire end.
Well, you know, it certainly could have been Penske's day again. And when you look at the top four, Penske definitely asserted themselves. Not Will Power, unfortunately. He was mired back towards the end of the field thanks to a red flag that was none of his doing in qualifying for a crash by Coletti that brought out the red before he could get in a good flyer. And then a sequence of events relegated him to the back of the field. But still, Juan Pablo Montoya was right up there in the mix, fighting with Pagano for third position by the end of the race. Elio Castroneves never let Scott Dixon pull ahead of him, even though he finished in second. It all came down to that paddle in the pit lane about halfway through the race. They were joking after in the press conference that Dixon needs to buy Tony Kanaan a beer, or at least a nice juicy steak, seeing as TK doesn't drink. Because that is what it all came down to. For a race that was, for IndyCar's sake, thankfully very clean, it was almost too clean to a fault. Yeah, that one caution for debris that lasted four laps. In fact, you could argue that the most exciting thing that happened during that race was thanks to Dracone for holding up the field. That's where most of the overtaking was, and trying to get past him. He unfortunately messed up the battle at the end for Sebastian Bourdais, who was trying to break into the top five and lost about 6 seconds just trying to get around Dracone. So I think all in all, pretty good weekend for IndyCar. Nice to have a good, clean race, but not a lot happening on track, for better or for worse.
And Joel, 36th career IndyCar Series win for Scott Dixon. He got past Elio in the pits early and really never looked back. He breaks a tie with Bobby Unser for fifth all-time on the wins list. Where now does Dixon stack among the greats? You know, there's a lot of, obviously, history in the IndyCar Series. There's been a lot of great drivers. But for Scott Dixon to move fifth all-time on the wins list, it has to be a big jump for him.
Well, personally, it's not something he's thinking about at all. It's something he says that's sinking in, but it's also not something he's even remotely worried about. That's something that you look back on after the fact. For him, it's taking it race to race. Now, from a fan's perspective, from a media perspective, we can debate this all day. It all comes down to the subjective judgment. Whatever you think is most important. Do you consider Indy 500 wins to be most important? Well, he only has one of those in 2008. You know, AJ has four, Alan Unser Sr., four, Rich Mears, four. Do you consider overall wins? Because Boyd has 67, Mario 52. You know, Michael has 42, but he's never won an Indy 500. So there are so many different things that you could consider with this, even the fact that not all generations are the same, are they? For IndyCar fans, we look towards the glory days, you know, looking back to the 60s, the 70s. Times like that seem to hold a little bit more significance, where by comparison, you mentioned Scott Dixon's number, but not all that far behind is Sebastian Bourdais with 32 from Champ Car. And I don't think he's someone that many people would be bringing up in the discussion for the greatest of all time, whether that's right or wrong. So there are so many different factors. I think it's impossible to gauge, and it's based mainly on what you feel is more important. I definitely would not put him in the AJ or Mario category, especially because of how much those guys mean for the sport and its growth over the years. But undoubtedly, he's one of the most talented drivers this series has seen on a variety of circuits, getting better and better at street courses recently, because Long Beach and St. Pete are places he's never had a lot of luck until really the last couple of years. So for Dixon, he's moving up on the list. Doesn't matter much to him. We could debate it all day. I think he's certainly top 10, and the numbers include that too.
With Penske's dominance this season, for Chip Ganassi and Scott Dixon to come out here at Long Beach and grab their first win on the season, do you look at Dixon now as the biggest threat to challenging Penske this season in the IndyCar Series?
Perhaps. I think that's fair. But his teammate Tony Kanaan is actually ahead of him in points, too. You know, we're so quick towards jumping to judgment. Penske's clearly the number one team. They have four of the best drivers and certainly the best equipment with Chevrolet. Now, that partnership has proven to be better than anyone with Honda thus far. But at the same time, let's look back. You know, NOLA was a very funky rain event. Nobody had a chance to assert themselves there. So we're judging things mainly, I think, off of two races, Long Beach, where it's next to impossible to pass, and St. Pete. And at St. Pete, was Penske above everybody else, and have they been for the first three races of the season? Yes, they have. But Elio is just 3 points back. You know, Montoya up front. You know, those are the two Penske's. And then, yeah, a bit of a gap. You have the two Ganassi cars with Tony Kanaan just 26 back, Dixon just 32. I think the season is far from over. And to wrap this up, to say it's a Penske pick'em for the title, I think Ganassi would definitely be the next closest, and either of those two, I think, would be definitely title contenders outside of the big four at Penske. But this season is far from over. And, you know, remember, the last time that Dixon won the title, Ganassi hadn't even won a race until Pocono more than halfway through the year. And then they, along with Honda, who they were running at the time, picked up the pace and won six out of the final nine. So you never know until you get a little bit further on in the season. I don't think that any pecking order has been established in stone, aside from the fact that Penske definitely does seem to be number one, and Ganassi is right on up there, but that could change.
Well, an interesting clean race at Long Beach. One caution, four laps, and it's kind of ironic that after the week before at NOLA that it was such a remarkably different kind of race, which was great. And again, I think we saw some interesting performances. One driver that I was impressed with for a lot of the race was Joseph Newgarden. Joseph did a nice job, and there were some drivers throughout the race that kind of made their presence felt. And, you know, I think it's interesting to me that that race went so clean after the week before, and I wonder if it was some sort of a conscious thing on the drivers' minds or if it was just the difference in the course. I love Long Beach, actually, even though it's really tough to pass there.
I certainly love it, too. Wouldn't debate not being able to pass either, but it is what it is. You know, Monaco is one of the marquee events for Formula One, and it's next to impossible to pass there, too. But it's got the history. It's got the atmosphere. It's got all these other things that totally make it worth coming back. As for drivers who impress, it's a little disappointing for Joseph Newgarden, I think, to come home in seventh. After making the fast six, I thought for sure this could have been the event that he finally gets off the schneid and picks up his first victory. So I think even being in the top ten is had a bit of a disappointment for him. The other driver I'm really impressed with, and I'm torn on a lot of things about his career, where I think he is, where I think he should be, because I'm not convinced that he's the most amazing American talent who's come along in the last few years. But Connor Daly, getting the ride with Coyne.
Yes.
Carlos Huertas was actually taken out of the car for whatever reason, certainly rumored to be monetary, go figure. Rocky Moran jumped in the car, and within his first practice session, got into an incident with Carlos Munoz where he closed the door after he was already in there completely. A foolish incident that never should have happened, given that he has mirrors and should have awareness of everything that's around him. But injured his thumb, and Connor Daly, who's just been around the paddock, you know, it's almost like he's got the helmet in hand waiting for something like this, jumped in the car and actually turned the second fastest Honda lap of the race. So he finished in 17th position, wasn't a contender up front, nor would you expect him to be. But in a situation like that, it's not even about picking up a top 10. It's about what can you do for the team? Can you give them good feedback? And that's something I'm not sure Connor has necessarily done at other points in his career. It takes a very mature driver to do that. And if he did that, he could be a very valuable asset to some teams down the road. So if he didn't perform well here, if he didn't press people on his team, there's a very realistic chance that this could have been maybe not the last effort, so to speak, for Connor Daly. But, you know, if things didn't go well here, then it would not bode well for the rest of his career. But it sounds as though it did. I think he still has a lot of fans on his side. He still has media on his side. If he can get Coyne on his side, who knows what will happen once these contracts run out? Because Dale Coyne will foot the bill for somebody. I think we've seen in the past, provide that he believes in them and that they are an asset on the racetrack. But it needs to be a combination of things in order for him to do that.
Well, from all the feedback that I was seeing on social media from different folks that were on hand, they said Connor did a great job with the feedback and the team was really happy with him. So, you know, I'd have to think that this could be the start of something for him. And certainly I think he performed respectably given the last-minute nature of the situation, a la Eric Jones in the NASCAR race at Bristol. With that, we'll step aside for a moment. When we come back, Joel continues with us. We've got Indy Lights and F1 to talk about. Open Wheel Central continuing right after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, winyournewcar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American dream car contest giveaway at winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming, start driving with winyournewcar.com.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cottman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cottman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cottman and let your local Cottman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cottman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cottman, real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cottman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cottman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
If you're a gearhead, you probably go online to those hot rod superstores, drooling over the chrome and speed goodies until you find just the right item for your muscle car, tuner car, truck. But what do you do when it comes to fixing the mom mobile? If you're like most do-it-yourselfers, you head to the strip mall parts store and talk to the "Do you want fries with that?" kid behind the counter. Hold on, Bunky. Did you stop to think where those chain stores are getting the parts that you're installing in the vehicle that's used to transport your family everywhere? They get the cheapest suppliers they can find to sell you the parts at bargain prices. They're limited lifetime warranties. What a joke. Remember the last time mom's car broke down? You heard about that one for weeks. Don't take that chance again. Excelsior Racing has the quality parts you need for your family vehicle. Parts that you can install knowing you're getting the best for your family. Excelsior Racing. Quality parts. Personalized service. Affordable pricing. Fast to you direct. Excelsior Racing. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
Hi everybody, this is Geddy Lee for RAD. To many of us, drunk driving is something that other people do. Certainly not one of our friends or relatives would do such a thing. When you see someone who's had too much to drink, about to get into a car, urge them to give up the keys and find alternate transportation. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives, you should too.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Time now for Open Wheel Central with our resident wine and cheeser, Joe Sebastianelli. Here to pop the cork is Race Chaser Online's managing editor, Jacob Seelman.
Poor Tom Baker, Jacob Seelman, is off today. He will be back in the saddle next Monday night on the Madness. Tom Baker, Marshall Gabell, James Pike, Kyle Magda, all of us from Race Chaser Online, along with our fellow race chaser, Joel Sebastianelli. And Joel with us via the phone. We've been talking IndyCar from Long Beach. Going to switch, talk some Indy Lights from Long Beach. And you know, as much as we talked on the NASCAR side, Joel, about Joey Logano leading 300 out of 300 laps, well, it was just as dominating a performance, pretty much, for Ed Jones, 3 for 3 now in the Indy Lights. What gives there? Wow.
It's so impressive to me, everything they've been able to do to roll off of the plane from Europe, come to the United States in a series that they've never competed in before, and go 3 for 3 to start the season. It's a testament, I think, to Ed Jones. But it's a testament to Carlin and how strong they've been in different junior formula over the years, whether it's been with Fernando Alonso, who, in speaking to Trevor this weekend, says that he thinks that's the best driver he's ever had drive for him. But he's had so many, from who have graduated to the Formula One ranks mainly, but they still have their eyes set on IndyCar at some point within the next year or two. And especially given how similar the IL-15 is to the DW12, I think going forward this is going to be a great step for them to grow as a brand. Overseas especially, it'll be good for Indy Lights in the long run, I think, as more European teams see the value in this and perhaps come over to the United States to compete with Carlin over here. It's forcing everybody else to up their games. That actually sports in the race. So Jack Harvey started on pole in a fantastic qualifying session. He was sixth when the checkered flag came out just after he crossed the line. Still had one more flying lap. Everyone was congratulating Spencer Pigot and Ricardo Juncos, the team owner of Juncos Racing. And Harvey took the fastest lap, actually set the track record of 112 knots, about 1 second quicker than Indy Lights has ever gone there. But Harvey had his race more or less ended on the opening lap. He still made it to about the halfway point, but an incident with Kyle Kaiser on the opening lap knocked him out of contention, lost a couple of laps. Great job by Schmidt-Peterson Motorsports to put the rear wing back on. But Ed Jones, just like that, was able to move right up into the top two from fourth and got around Felix Sorales on the first corner of the restart on lap three, never looked back. So it was a bit of a strange race in that regard, but much like the Montoya-Pagano battle in IndyCar, with Spencer Pigot right behind. Pigot had a car just as fast as Jones did, but it's so tough to pass at Long Beach. He never found the opportunity in those final 10 laps. 3 for 3, a pretty good start. Can't get much better than that. Not just on the season, but in the series for Carlin. It's so impressive everything they've done. To the credit, these teams haven't done a lot of whining about it. They've all gotten significantly better just in the weeks from St. Pete to Long Beach.
And we talk so much about Carlin and Ed Jones being so dominant in the Indy Lights. Of course, Austin Cindric is one of those drivers that's running for Carlin over in Europe and also doing some continental sports car tire stuff. Obviously Austin's father, one of the presidents over at Penske Racing. So Carlin's certainly dominating the ranks in their transition over to America and the Indy Lights. But the one that everyone was watching during a rain delay during the Cup race on Sunday was the F1 race, and reigning champion Lewis Hamilton showing his domination again, winning once again in the Formula One series, and just an impressive start for his season. Kimi Raikkonen with a strong run in second for Ferrari. A typical F1 race, to be honest. It wasn't a challenger race. It came down to just the reigning champion showing his true form again.
Well, I still hate that phrase that gets thrown around way too often, so I'll call you out for it. Typical F1 race is used as such a negative term. But the fact of the matter is, I'm sure if you took the percentage of races in any series, including NASCAR, which is the group of people who love to use that phrase, they're not all crackers from beginning to end. They're not all that outstanding. I thought that even though there wasn't a ton of overtaking in that race, there were still some exciting battles through the field, perhaps taking a little more patience to watch those come through. But Kimi Raikkonen stalking over the course of about 10, 15 laps, gaining a second or two on Rosberg for second place, and then overtaking him with just two to go. I thought that was pretty exciting to see that unfold gradually over a long period of time. The question here that arises is, even though Kimi Raikkonen isn't all that close to Lewis Hamilton, he only has 42 points accumulated over the year compared to 93 far and away for Lewis Hamilton in first place for the championship. What I wonder, though, is could Sebastian Vettel and Raikkonen ultimately be a bigger threat to the title than his own teammate Nico Rosberg? Rosberg had trouble with the brake line in the closing laps, but even though you could argue the brake line was the main reason Nico lost that position to Kimi Raikkonen, it seemed like it could have been another mental lapse. We've seen it at Monza. When Nico Rosberg is pressured from behind, he's prone to making mistakes. So I wonder how much that factored into things. Even though Lewis Hamilton towards the end was having that exact same problem, he just had a big enough gap over everybody else that it didn't make a difference in the end, with the race being as many laps as it was. So Ferrari could be the number one threat to Mercedes. I think we know that much. The real question is, Sebastian Vettel, who finished fourth in could have been on the podium if not for some incidents that unfolded earlier in the race and a mistake on his own going wide in a couple of the corners. You know, if Vettel can string together a few podiums in a row, and most importantly, a couple of victories, I think with perhaps a mechanical failure, for example, for Lewis Hamilton, it wouldn't be outside the realm of possibility to see one of those Ferraris challenge.
Okay, so you said a mouthful in that. I'm going to try to pull a couple of points out of there. First, I'm going to half agree with Marshall. I think it kind of was a typical F1 race in the sense that I think if you just look at the result and Lewis Hamilton winning, I'm going to allow for the fact that because of the brake issues that both of those cars were having, I think we saw, you know, Raikkonen, I think another lap and you might have had a different winner, at least maybe two laps at most. You might have had a different winner in that event, first of all. Second of all, it was definitely an interesting race in the sense that, as you say, I think Ferrari established itself as a contender for the title, but I do agree that Vettel has got to get a couple of wins. So my question to you is, Joel, where do you see Vettel having the best chance to get a couple, two, three wins to actually climb into this and really challenge Lewis Hamilton? Because the what I'm looking at the next two, three races on the schedule, I'm saying, you know what, if Lewis just plays his cards right, doesn't do anything silly, I would say he's got a pretty good shot at making a little bit of a mockery of this season. What do you say?
Well, I don't think they're anywhere near as dominant as being able to make, you know, to use that phrase, a mockery. I don't think it'll get to that point. I think Ferrari, with the amount that they've improved from 2014 to 2015, yeah, I've changed my mind. I actually think they can be up there, whereas a couple weeks ago, I wouldn't have told you that. I think Ferrari has proven that they can challenge for a couple of wins. Still all of Red Bull from last year, where Mercedes is definitely the number one, and I don't see that changing at any point during the season. But could they go ahead and steal three, four, perhaps even five races? I think they could. For what track, it's impossible to say. So much changes from year to year that I don't think it's quite as obvious that, and this is no hit on the series at all, but, you know, NASCAR and IndyCar, for example, I think it's a little easier to look at past events and say, oh, well, you know, a certain driver has been strong here, so he should be strong here again. It doesn't always work that way in Formula One. So I think the question is going to be more, you know, where is the team in particular done really well? And Ferrari, with Fernando Alonso especially, has been fairly good at Catalunya, where the series is going to be coming up to in the beginning of May, to start off the string of European races. So perhaps it could happen there. There's no way to prognosticate when exactly, but I do think that Ferrari has it in them to keep it interesting throughout the season.
All right, we'll see what happens over the next few races. Of course, I'm already ready for Memorial Day weekend in Monaco and Indy and Charlotte, all the greatest races of that weekend. Already ready for that. Joel Sebastianelli from Mazda Road to Indy TV, and also, of course, Race Chaser Online and Formula One Racing Plus right here on PMN. Thanks for joining us. Have a great rest of the week, and we will catch you next Monday night. And with that, we're going to step aside. When we come back, we're going from open wheel to dirt tracks. So we're going to be talking with Stephen Evans from Turn 5 Live, talking some World of Outlaws. Right after this, on Motorsports Madness, you're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
Do you hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette, it's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes, on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit, Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
On the air, you may know me as the man about motorsports. Actually, I've been the man about insurance for over 30 years. With one call, I can cover your life, health, auto, home, and business insurance. Recently, I saved a young couple over $500 on their annual car insurance bill. No gimmicks and no green lizard. So if you think your insurer is really your good neighbor who is on your side because he is holding your money in his good hands, think again. Call me, 703-631-8000. I have dozens of insurance companies waiting to give you the protection you need and deserve. It may take more than 15 minutes, but you'll receive sound advice, quality professional service, and an honest opinion. That number again, 703-631-8000. Ask for Larry Ellis.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
Coming to Tampa Bay, I said we want to win a Super Bowl, and I believe we will.
From IamSecond.com.
We came close, but never really did win that championship.
Former NFL head coach Tony Dungy.
At the end of my 6th year, I was fired, and it was one of the biggest disappointments of my life. Next year, I'm in Indianapolis, get to the playoffs, but get knocked out again. And for the next couple of years, it's the same thing. Everyone is saying Colts are never going to win one. And I did wonder, why didn't it pan out the way I thought it would? But I determined that I had to have Christ first, and that everything else came below that, including my own desires. The next year, that ended up being our year to go to the Super Bowl and win it. And it was a wonderful feeling. Every decision I make, I'm going to make it through the lens of Jesus Christ. And he'd guide us to that ultimate victory.
Watch Tony's story at IamSecond.com.
Hi, the kids. It's time to get dirty on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness. Here are your hosts, Jacob, Tom, and Kyle, with Turn 5 Live's curator of Casa de Pork Chop, Stephen Ovens.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Tom Baker, Marshall Cabell, Kyle Magda, and joining us now, Stephen Ovens from Turn 5 Live here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman is off tonight. He'll be back in the saddle next Monday. And Steve-O, first of all, welcome to the program. And second of all, the world of outlaws just keep on percolating. And boy, that schedule, every time I look at their schedule, I get tired just reading it.
Yeah, they finally just got through the California swing. Yeah. I was checking out some pictures that teams were posting about finishing the California tour, and you know, a team that we always follow close here in our location in the Northeast is the Shark Racing boys, Logan Schuhart and Jacob Allen, and they are two guys, and of course they're younger guys as well. You know, very active on the social media stuff, and kind of cool to see them. You know, they've just wrapped up their second tour of California. Pretty awesome feat for them for a low budget team, and fun to follow those guys along. But yeah, grueling schedule there in California. Now everything shifts toward Texas.
Well, let's not get out of California too soon here. Got a couple of races to talk about. First of all, Shane Stewart getting a victory. And you know what? Every time Shane has a good runner, gets a win, for some reason, I just enjoy that. I mean, that's a neat story, this whole team. And good to see them stepping up and having a good run. And Shane also, of course, Paul McMahon winning at Paris Auto the next night, and I think Shane ended up on the pole for that one. So those two drivers had a great weekend, but Shane in particular is just really showing some spunk right now.
Yeah, I've mentioned it on this show several times to Jacob in particular, is the fact that, you know, we've been waiting and waiting and waiting for this, you know, first full-time year slump to kind of happen with this relatively new team. I mean, this is their first full go at it.
Yeah.
On the whole tour. And it's not that I'm rooting against them. I've been waiting for that. Okay. That initial spark, that firecracker is now gone out, and now the grueling schedule is going to start getting to them. But, Tom, here we are. We're at the end of the California tour. They've got two wins now. And as of Sunday night, now they only trail Donnie Schatz by 23 points, which is a pretty amazing feat when you consider Donnie already has five wins. So, I mean, like I said, I'm not rooting against them. I've just been waiting for them to slow down, and they haven't yet. So they're sitting in second in points as we head for the Texas Outlaw Nationals and sitting in a great spot. If they can just keep riding this momentum, I mean, who knows, Tom, if they hit a hot streak in the summer like we're accustomed to seeing Donnie do, I mean, if they're right there where they are now, 23 points back, I mean, the whole series could change in one race when you're only 23 points back.
Well, there's no question about that. And, of course, you had Daryl Pittman coming back, too, after coming off his injury. And he missed just a weekend, just the one race weekend. And you know, when
which
you talk
I'm shocked
about,
by.
Yeah, I am, too, honestly. I'm amazed he's back so soon. But it just goes to show you the grit that boy has for driving a race car, that he wasn't going to be kept out any longer than he absolutely had to. But you talk about the points. I mean, it seemed like, again, we were going to talk about a runaway, but Shane Stewart is definitely keeping himself in and tight. And as you say, one race can make all the difference, and at the rate Shane's going, I mean, you keep waiting for the slowdown, and I'm in the opposite chair over here. I'm saying momentum is an amazing thing, and the more they run well, the more confidence they get. Something tells me that we're not going to stop seeing Shane Stewart at the front of fields anytime soon. This could be a major upset year where Shane Stewart comes out of the box and runs for the title and wins the title at the rate he's going. I know you say it's still early in the season, but boy, that team is just so consistent right now, and they've got the personnel to do it too.
Oh, they do. They have the resources to do it. And although they're not, as far as years, you know, on the circuit, they're not proven yet, but they've certainly got the resources to do it. And I fully expect that we'll see that out of them. But don't count Pittman out either, because he could go on a run. He only missed a weekend. So, I mean, that doesn't put him that far behind.
No.
But, you know, we'll see what happens. But let's shift gears a little bit and talk about the World of Outlaw Late Models, Lion Eye 100 over the weekend. And how about this? Brandon Shepherd picks up the win, had to beat the best of the best. Darrell Lanigan, the Kentucky Colonel, had to beat Shannon Babb, an Illinois native as well. It's just a great race for Shepherd, because, you know, you look at where he was last year in a fill-in role for the Rocket Chassis team when Josh Richards was out. And then, you know, at a certain point, Shepherd decided to go back home and focus on his own team. And now he comes back and takes, you know, starts 12th and then moves all the way up to the top spot and takes the Illini 100 win. Just a fantastic performance from Shepherd over the weekend. And it just, you know, really a kind of, for me, you know, you go to these big 100-lap races that, you know, everybody circles on the calendar, and you think of, you know, guys like Blomqvist, who won the preliminary the night before. You don't necessarily think about Brandon Shepherd taking the win on Saturday night, but he's so good that even when you see his name on the box score, it's not a huge surprise to you. It's just that it was a pleasant surprise to see him there.
Well, for sure, absolutely, and an interesting surprise, and if we can have a little word fun, a surprising surprise announcement this afternoon: Billy Moyer Jr. indefinitely taking a leave of absence. Steve, were you as blown away by that as I was?
I'm blown away, Tom, but I think I'm confused more than anything. I mean, the it says right in the release that, you know, he's one of the drivers that, you know, is at the top of their game, that has the most, you know, financial support with sponsors that he's ever had in his career. and this early in the season to just decide that you want to do something else and not focus on your racing career. And he's a young guy. I mean, we're talking about a guy at 27 years old. So I'm kind of perplexed about it. I don't know what to think. I want to be positive and say that, you know, this is he's doing this all for, you know, to make him a happier person. But, you know, I think sometimes the way the world is now, Tom, we always think in the back of our minds that there's just a guy who's got it all right now to just give it away. I mean, there's so many guys that would love to have that kind of opportunity.
Yeah.
That it really makes us sit back in our chair when we see somebody just, you know, decide that they want to focus on something else and just walk away. I think that's where everybody's at right now.
Yeah, just not something that I think anybody saw coming. I actually had the chance to talk with a couple of other folks that I know from that series that who expressed the same surprise and shock that I was in when I saw the article, actually saw it come out on our site, Race Chaser Online. I was busy with other things today and saw it pop up. An amazing thing. And I wish it well. And I'd like to say, I hope it's short lived and he comes back, but number one, you gotta be happy. So,
that's,
you know,
true.
We certainly wish him the best and, we'll see where it goes from here. Okay. Let's, do a little bit of a lightning round here with you, Steve, just about 30 seconds apiece. First of all, let's go to the short track super series, Brett Deo's series up north. Opened up at Bridgeport, and Rick Laubach got the win. It was the first race for that South region in the history of the series. Not bad.
No, not bad at all. Started on the pole, got the win, led every lap, took home over $5,400 in prize and lap money, and you know, not bad for a lap, you know, a race less than 100 laps. You take home $5,400. Not a bad deal.
Not a bad deal at all. And, of course, Utica Rome Speedway up in New York under new management. We talked with Bill Shea earlier, actually late last year after the transition took place, the new owner, Bill and Kim, a packed house, and the races were done in time for a friend of mine to drive about an hour back to his house. It was home by 10:30 last night. You got to love it when you have a full grandstand, a full pit area, and you're still done in probably, what, about three and a half hours.
Absolutely. That's the map. That's the blueprint for how to run a dirt track race. And, oh, by the way, the two guys on the top of their game as far as dirt modifieds go right now, Matt Shepard and Stuart Friesen, took wins, as well as the Flying Squirrel, Rocky Warner, took the Sportsman win. So when all those guys take wins on opening night, that's never a bad thing for ticket sales.
All right, Steve, fast 15 minutes with you. We certainly appreciate you taking some time, and you can catch more of the dirt action on Turn 5 Live Tuesday night at 7:30 Eastern here on PMN. Thanks for joining us, Steve. We appreciate it.
We'll see you next week.
That's Steven Evans. We're going to step aside. When we come back, we have got more stuff going on. We're going to switch and talk Pirelli for a little while, the Pirelli World Challenge, and then we'll talk V8 supercars and who knows what else before we're done here tonight. Stay with us. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com, enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest. At WinYourNewCar.com, complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here.
Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this could be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? When you have to take your car into the shop, look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE blue seal of excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
My very first movie, it was called British Terabithia, and that was a film that a lot of kids loved.
From IamSecond.com.
It felt very cool in my heart to know that I did something nice.
Actress Bailey Madison.
I don't want it to be about me, I want it to be about God. Even though you have an Earth Father, He is your Father, that you can say to Him, God, I'm not feeling too well today. Or if it's just, you know, little things like, I feel homesick here. I need you, Lord. I need to feel happiness in my heart. The most important thing is you have to have hope. You have to have faith. God is with you, and God is with you every step of the way. If you give yourself to God and you say, I'm ready to commit myself to you, you will know that God is watching you. He looks out and He goes, I'm very, very happy with what you just did. My name is Bailey Madison, and I am Second.
Hi, this is Spencer Davis, driver of the 79 Coors Light 21 meets 21 Pontiac in the NASCAR Wheeling Southern Modified Torque. Now back to Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness on a Monday night, stormy Monday night. At least where most of us are here on the Performance Motorsports Network. We hope that where you are, the weather is okay and you are safe and sound. Talking motorsports for about another 45 minutes or so. And right now, joining us on the program as we switch gears once again from the dirt to the Pirelli World Challenge Series, Hunter Smith back on the program, our Pirelli analyst. And Hunter, it's awfully cool to see whenever the Pirelli World Challenge Series is the companion race for the IndyCar set, because in my mind, even though obviously they look nothing alike, I see a lot of similarities in those two particular series, and Pirelli does such a great job promoting their stuff. But what a weekend it was at Long Beach for them, and I know you're anxious to share your points of view on what went on over the weekend in the Pirelli series.
Oh, yeah. It was a great weekend out at Long Beach for the Pirelli World Challenge. Depending on who you ask, I guess there were a lot of cautions in the in round five. I mean, round five was the only round this weekend. It was sole race for the World Challenge and a lot of cautions, and clock doesn't stop. In a 50-minute race, you have a lot of caution time. It doesn't really help the racing. But as far as some guys do, I went into the race thinking Johnny O'Connell was going to come out on top in the number three Cadillac. And, you know, he won Long Beach in 2014, and he needed a solid run this weekend. He's having a little bit of a rough season. I thought Michael Lewis, you know, he's running well this season in GTA and the number 41 Porsche. He's won three. He won three out of four races going into this weekend. And in GTC, you could not go against Colin Thompson. You know, he... in the number 11 Porsche, he's won three out of the four races so far in GTC, so I went with him as well going in. However, in GT, it was once again all about Olivier Beretta in the number 61 Ferrari for Arferi Motorsport. He was third in practice. He won qualifying, and he took first in a heated GT battle. Peter Cunningham was also, he showed a little bit of speed this weekend. You know, he was fast in practice. The all-wheel drive Acura, the number 42, was up there a little bit, so that was pretty cool. In GTA, my prediction, Michael Lewis, number 41 Porsche, he went right in, and sure enough, second in practice, first in qualifying, and went right to the top in round five and took the win there. Frank Montecalvo, he was first in practice, so he was doing pretty fast too. Just had a little bit of bad luck in the race, that's for sure. And in GTC, once again, Colin Thompson in the number 11 Porsche 911, first in practice, first in qualifying, first in the race. The Porsche Bucks County car is on a roll this season, and he can't be stopped. The only cars coming close to him, from what I've seen, is Sloan Urey, and you know he's on a roll too. But as far as Colin Thompson, I don't know what they got in the water up in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, but that Porsche is on a roll so far this season.
Well, I know that for some of these guys, I mean, just looking at Michael Lewis, for example, and Thompson, just dominant performances. What do you attribute some of these strong runs by these particular drivers to? I mean, I know that they both are with strong teams, but still, especially Thompson, just a totally dominant weekend in the GTC.
Well, you know, it's funny about Colin and going into the season with a brand new team, it was kind of iffy as to who was going to brand new. It was a brand new class with the GTC altogether. So, you know, no one really knew what to expect coming in. And Colin and he's a one car team with the Porsche Bucks County car. And he's coming out and just doing all of it. So I attribute his success right to his driving talent. I mean, the kid's got quite the foot and he's got the hand eye coordination to go with it. So he's all over and he's snapping necks and cashing checks, so to speak, on the track. That's for sure.
Well, there's a new one. We need to mark that down in the studio here, guys. Snapping necks and cashing checks. I like that. Four wins in five races. I'd say that's probably fairly accurate. It's really quite the weekend. Now you're obviously a big part of the Pirelli series in terms of being a fan and also hoping someday to be a participant. When Pirelli goes to a track like Long Beach, I mean, they run some amazing facilities, but we talked earlier about how hard it is to pass for the Indy cars at Long Beach. Is it the same for Pirelli, or do they seem to be able to handle the track better?
Well, you know, as far as Long Beach goes, if we had some green flag racing this week, there would have been quite a bit of passing, I have a feeling. But like I said, there was a lot of caution time, yeah. And obviously no passing going on under caution. So during the green flag runs, there was quite a bit of passing. You know, Johnny O'Connell and Kevin Estro were making runs at Olivier Beretta for the lead until eventually the three of them came together, and O'Connell and Estro kind of got the bad end of that heading into the tire barrier. But, you know, there was passing. There was side-by-side racing for the green flag runs that they had. I was extremely happy with what they did.
Now, I like the next course they're going to, Barber Motorsports Park. Always a fan of that facility, coming up on the 24th through the 26th of this month. Round 6 and 7 for the GT, the GTA and GTCs, and 5 and 6 for the GTS. What do you look for at Barber Motorsports Park, and who should we be watching for other than Colin Thompson, who seems like we should be watching for him no matter where they go?
Yeah, for sure. You know, that's the thing. Colin's been able to adapt to all these tracks that it's crazy how he's doing it. So a Barber, it's a little bit of a toss-up. You know, a Barber's quite the facility, and you always expect to see great racing. So I don't expect anything short of great racing. I'm happy the GTS class is coming back this weekend. You know what? I hope nothing's been confirmed yet. I haven't heard anything, but last GTS race, Spencer Pompelli was in, and if he comes back this weekend, I would like to see him run well, and I expect that he would. And other than that, you know, I got to go with Beretta in GT. He's on a roll. That Ferrari is just on point every week. I expect to see him do well. Michael Lewis, obviously, with the effort racing guys, he's on a roll in GTA. And like you said, Colin Thompson, that GTC, that Porsche, he's unstoppable. So see what these guys do. I mean, a lot of teams had some damage from Long Beach, and now they're coming into – they got to go straight to Barber and be a Barber by Wednesday. So we'll see if some teams don't even make the entry list.
Interesting. Well, we'll keep our eyes on that. Certainly, you will keep your eyes on it for us, and we look forward to – wrapping up the Barber shows with you after they take place. And hopefully Mother Nature will be kind to that racing as she was at Long Beach for the most part. So definitely excited about that. And Hunter, we appreciate you coming on with us and look forward to having you back after Barber to rehash that with us as well.
Well, I appreciate it, guys. I think this will be the first time that I come on 2 weeks in a row. So we had a little bit of break in the schedule with the PWC. But next Monday, I will be here to do it all about Barber.
Well, we're looking forward to that. We'll see what happens this weekend. Thanks, Hunter. That's Hunter Smith. And Marshall Gabell, I want to switch gears again. You know, we always take our audience on quite the trip through the motorsports landscape on Monday nights. It's almost, you know, let's see how many different types of racing we can cover in 2 hours. And we're going to go from four wheels to two wheels this time and talk some Supercross. And I got two words for you, Marshall, and I'm just going to let you say what you want from there because I'm not sure what else can be said. Ryan Dungey.
Absolutely. Ryan Dungey, we're in a 14 races into the 17 race schedule, and he's already clinched the championship, his second Monster Energy Supercross championship after the runner-up finish in Houston. But the bigger picture that I want to focus on is Cole Seeley getting the victory for Honda. I mean, Cole's in his rookie season, and he has just taken off. It's been podium, and then it'll be, you know, a fifth place finish. But no matter what, he's always been there after the whole shot, and that's what eventually got him this win in Houston. And then what can you say about Ryan Dungey, going back to that point, to capture it three races still left in the season? I know that Ken Roczen has had his issues with the injuries in practice at Daytona, and some of the contenders have fallen off, but just it's incredible to see someone as dominant as he has been. It's almost like a Villopoto of a few seasons ago.
Well, you know, that's I was going to mention that the name Ryan Villopoto, because really Ryan Dungey, Ryan Villopoto have been the story of the last how many years in Supercross. And now with Villopoto stepping away to go take on the world, so to speak, Dungey really had the open door, and he has certainly taken advantage of it. And Cooper Webb also coming back from a mid-race incident to win his sixth 250 West race of the 2015 season, Marshall, and a good win for Cooper as well, and a big season so far for him in the 250 series.
Oh, absolutely. He's been dominant in the West Series. And one more point about Ryan Dungey, 13th consecutive podium finish for him going back to the beginning of this season.
Yes. And with that, we are going to take a break. When we come back, James Pike rejoins us. We're going to get out under, talk about V8 supercars and much more. Of course, we got our infamous by now prognostications about Richmond weekend as well coming up. We never know what we're going to hit in the last half hour. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back around the corner. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, WinYourNewCar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American dream car contest giveaway at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming, start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Hands can do incredible things. They made every sound in this piece of music. But nothing compares to using them to help save a life. If an adult suddenly collapses, call 911, then push hard and fast in the center of their chest until help arrives. It's called hands-only CPR, and it's recommended by the American Heart Association. Visit handsonlycpr.org today. A message from the American Heart Association and the Ad Council.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cottman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cottman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cottman and let your local Cottman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cottman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cottman, real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cottman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and fine folks at Cottman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs.
From IamSecond.com.
Well, when I got to 17, I was playing in after-hours bars, just in a bunch of trouble.
Grammy Award winner Michael W. Smith.
Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there, it was LSD, and your compass sort of just like disappeared. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out. I was very depressed. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was just weeping. I was weeping. And I just began to just cry out for God. 12:30 at night, on the linoleum floor of my kitchen, the God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor. I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. I'm a son of the High King of the universe.
Watch Michael's story at IamSecond.com.
Time to get back to tonight's Motorsports Madness. Here are the only three of a kind that beat the full house. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Here on the Performance Motorsports Network, talking motorsports for about another 30 minutes or so. Tom Baker from RaceChaserOnline.com, along with Marshall Gabel and Kyle Magda. And James Pike will be rejoining us shortly as well. Jacob Seelman, the evening off tonight. He will be back.
Wait just a minute. Try that again. Try that one more time.
Can we cue a J.R. Ross? Oh, my God.
Apparently, we have a Jacob Seelman. I can't call it a sighting because we can't actually see him. I guess we have a Jacob Seelman hearing. Rumor has it Jacob Seelman just couldn't stay away for the whole show. So he has returned, and because he didn't tell me he was coming back, I'm just going to hand him control. Go ahead, Jacob. It's all yours.
Oh, don't hand me control just yet. We still got half an hour yet to go, and I've still got a lot more to think about. Marshall, I want to turn to you for a minute because, you know, Ryan Dungey, 7 wins on the year. I'm a little excited about that. He did win in Santa Clara last week, if anybody was counting.
Yeah, he absolutely did. And, you know, we were talking about Cole's win 2 weeks ago and just how the rookie's been so impressive. But no one's been more impressive than Dungey this season. To walk off with the championship now in his hand, I mean, Dungey's en route. You know, he's already got the championship. Now it's just a matter of just picking up wins.
It's a matter of wins, and I'm looking forward to that. V8 Supercars, Tom. Marcus Ambrose is getting back in for a test session. Is it going to be him or Scott Pye in that 17? I don't know.
Well, I don't know either, but I do know that I hope that Marcus can get back in it and resume his career. You know, I really think this situation has been a very peculiar one, even though I know we got the explanation, Jacob, that Marcos was was simply feeling like his performance wasn't up to snuff and he needed more time to observe. The fact is that I don't think Scott has done much that Marcus didn't. And so, Jacob, I don't really know. I mean, I'd like to see Marcos get back in it, and I'm still pretty sure that we're going to see both of those guys in 2016. At least that's my hunch. So I think all of this really is about just the rest of this season, because I think you'll see a two-car team there next year. But I don't know, Jacob. I'm hoping for Marcos, but it's really going to depend, I think, on his confidence level more than it is anything else, because I don't think that it was the team's idea for him to step aside at all.
No, it was his idea. You know, we kept talking about that, and Marcos elected to step away. Marcos elected to give Scott Pye the seat so they could start to figure out what was wrong with the car. Scotty figured out that, hey, it's the car having the problems. It's doing exactly what Marcos told all of y'all it was doing, and now we just got to figure out how to fix it. And I think they're in the stage of using this upcoming test session to try and fix some of the things that are ailing them. I know James Pike will want to speak more of that in just a little while, but so much going on and still so much more. Marshall, I want to turn back to you for a minute because we were on two wheels and got away from it for a minute. I want to go back to two wheels because MotoGP was in action over the weekend as well. Mark Marquez and Valentino Rossi, the future greatest of all time and the greatest of all time in MotoGP competition, go head-to-head in Argentina. Rossi wins. Marquez crashes trying to get the win. And through it all, Andrea Dovizioso comes home second. And all of this after the race had an air of Marquez crashed trying to beat the best. Are you kidding me?
Craziness. The way that Valentino Rossi has opened the season, I think he's certainly going to be a contender to Marquez this season after Mark pretty much walked off with it last season. But, you know, MotoGP, it's going to be the battle of Rossi versus Marquez this season as their year heats up. It's going to be fun to watch. And, you know, let's go back to the four wheels and talk a little bit about the V8 supercars. You know, Tom said it earlier, we take you all over the place on Motorsports Madness. It's like a roller coaster ride, to be honest. So let's turn back to James Pike, V8 correspondent, and let's talk a little bit more about Marcos Ambrose in this upcoming test.
Yeah, Marshall, it's going to be interesting because the plan at Penske is to head to, I believe, Queensland Raceway. I will double check that as we go through here. But we're going to have both Scott Pye and Marcus Ambrose get in the same car on the same test day. Now, it should be noted that as per the V8 Supercar rules, every single team is restricted to, I believe, it's three test days, if my memory isn't mistaken. DJR Team Penske is already down to their last one. So, going to be very interesting to see how they work about this, Tom, because you look at this team, you look at the reason Marcus Ambrose decided to step back. He said he needed more experience. Unless we don't know something that they do, if they're out of test days, then what do we expect? Do we expect him to get maybe behind a simulator or maybe try and get him in some Dunlop Series races to get the experience he feels like he needs in order to be competitive when he gets back to the big show?
I don't know. I mean, Jacob and I were talking about that just before you got back squared away here. And I just don't know where this goes, to be honest with you. As I said, I think for 2016, I still have a hunch you're going to see both of them driving cars for the Penske team, but I think for the rest of this season, I think I think it really depends, James, on Marcos's confidence, wouldn't you say?
Potentially. But I think, and I know Jacob and I have talked about this a little bit at length, and I'm fairly certain he agrees with me. If he wants to rebut that, I'll give him the chance here in just a moment. But I think it will come down most likely to a situation where it will be next year that Marcus returns back to racing in the V8 Supercar Series. I think DJR Team Penske will go to two cars. I expect Scott Pye to have that other ride locked down because there's absolutely no doubt in my mind that Scott Pye is talented enough. You understand that it was only, I believe, two seasons ago that he finished runner-up in the Dunlop Development Series to one Scott McLaughlin, who is now doing wonderful things over at GRM with the Volvos. So, Jacob, do you think that we're headed to a two-car team for 2016? And what do you think it will take to get Ambrose back into a car? And will we see him this season at all in the V8 Supercar Series?
Of course we'll see it this season. There's three Enduro races coming up in the latter half of the season, aren't there, James? I mean, come on. Who else are you going to get to drive that car? Go get the man in the moon? I don't know. No, Marcus will be in the car for the Enduros. I'm not worried about that at all. It's a matter now of what does it take to put that second car together. They've had the rolling sponsorship model the last couple of races. They're going to continue it here when we go back racing the first weekend in May. And you know, James, that's something we haven't seen a lot either in the V8 Supercars Championship, that Roger Penske, he's a businessman. He's going to make it work however the team is best going to run, and maybe pulling in sponsorship revenue from a lot of different places. Could that be the new norm? I don't know. We may find out. It may put them to two cars. We'll just have to wait and see. But on the topic of sponsorship, this rumor came across my desk the other day that I wanted to make sure I hit on with you, James, just for a second. The rumor has it that for 2016, when we see Shane Van Gisbergen jump over to a third 888 Commodore, rumor has it it's actually going to be Jamie Wincup and SVG behind the wheel of the two Red Bull-sponsored entries, and there's going to be something different going on behind the Craig Lowndes entry for 2016. Whether it's rumor or fact, we don't know yet. Roland Dane's keeping pretty tight-lipped, but it's interesting to think about.
It is interesting to think about, just given that Red Bull does have an ownership stake in the team, unless they've got some sort of other brand in the family that I'm not necessarily aware of, maybe the sugar-free Red Bull or something of the like, although the way you say that, at least to me, it carries the implication that it's going to be an entirely different brand. So I think we'll keep our eyes on that and see what happens, and obviously report on it at Race Chaser Online if we come up with anything. But regardless, this is 888 Racing we're talking about. It's not like they have trouble finding good sponsorship and good funding, because this has been the best team in the series for the better half of the last decade. So I think it will be more of a change of paint if that actually happens, and I don't think it will affect Lowndes' performance all that much, Tom. I would expect that the smiling, ever-present, happy Australian will be just the same behind the wheel next year, regardless of who's on his bonnet, as they call it.
His bonnet, appropriate, so shortly after Easter. I would agree with that. I mean, you know, he's a very, I want to say, consistent shoe. And I say that not in a sense that he's not one of the top shoes, but, you know, in the sense that I think he's just one of those drivers that no matter where he lands or what he's driving, he's just going to get the most out of it. And so I would agree with you. I think wherever he goes, James, he's going to do very well. Now, let's talk about what's upcoming for the V8 Supercars series. What do you see over the next several races? Where who's trending up and who's trending down in your mind?
Well, I think you always start with the obvious answer here, which is Jamie Wincup, because Jamie Wincup is historically very, very good in this part of the season. This is where Wincup has, in past seasons, been able to establish a points lead that normally he carries on towards the end of the season. Now, sometimes he can be chased closely. Craig Lowndes was able to run white with him in the points battle all the way to the next to last race of the season and that final event in Homebush. But that being said, you look at the tracks that are coming up and you look at the guys who are beginning to make runs and who have started off the season well. You've got Barbagallo, you've got Hidden Valley, and you've got, I believe, Townsville are the next three in line. Those are all three tracks where normally you don't see too many surprises. If you are a good driver and you have a good program set up for a good chunk of the season, usually you're going to see those guys do well. And to that end, if there's anybody that's going to be able to challenge Wincup this year, I think you have to look at the guys at Holden Racing Team. Courtney and Tander have had fantastic starts to the year, namely Courtney, who had the excellent run, and Clipsoil was able to win the Sunday race back-to-back. That I don't think has worn off yet, even though that was almost, maybe a month and a half ago. And I'd like to think that if we're going to see anything from Courtney and Tander, that we're going to start seeing a consistent challenge for the title when we get to Barbara Gallo and Hidden Valley. I think they will probably run well there if they have intentions of competing for the title throughout the rest of the season. That being said, we also can't forget the fact that the Ford Falcons of Pro Drive Racing absolutely obliterated the field in the non-points race event at Albert Park alongside the Formula One race there. Frosty and Chaz Mostert were spectacular there. They were on the podium all four races. So we'll see if that momentum can carry forward. But at the same time, you know, they haven't been all that strong outside of Albert Park. So it's very much a mixed bag, I think, on their front, which is not necessarily something the Ford fans want to hear, especially since you're looking at a situation where they might not even be racing the Falcon in 2016. Or if they do, Tom, it will be without the support of Ford Australia, at least for that season. We'll see if one Roger Penske has any ability to sway the executives down there for Ford. But as is, that's the reality that Pro Drive's facing.
That just that still just shocks me. I don't really understand that decision. I don't understand how that makes any sense whatsoever. And I surely would like to think that Roger Penske, as much as he is obviously such a huge part, I mean, right now he's the most successful part of Ford's NASCAR program, though Roush obviously did show signs of maybe still being on the right track this past weekend, and Front Row continues to kind of labor on, as does Petty. But right now, Penske is the Ford NASCAR program pretty much. And so it does surprise me, this whole decision with them in Supercar. We'll have to keep our eyes on that. And we will keep our eyes right now on our forecasts and our picks and talk Richmond and whole bunch of good stuff coming up still on our final segment of Motorsports Madness. Don't go anywhere. Back in just a moment, you're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
So you finally arrived at the sweet spot in your life. The kids are raised and gone. You have free time, and it's finally time to do something for you. If you've ever considered owning a Corvette but have been putting it off for years, now is the time to act. Isn't this the time to finally get that Corvette you always wanted and drooled and dreamed over? Well, grab the little lady by the hand and take her to Cooper Corvettes. They're conveniently located on Route 1 just off of I-95 and just north of the Marine Corps base. They have lots of pampered and well-maintained Corvettes in inventory, and if they don't have what you want, they'll find it. From classic Stingrays to modern-day cars, Cooper is your one-stop shop. And speaking of shops, they service what they sell. And even if you didn't buy a Cooper Corvette, they'll service your Corvette anyway. Become part of the Cooper Corvette family. Call them at 703-445-1483. That's 703-445-1483. And on the web at coopercorvettes.com. That's coopercorvettes.com, American pride and countrywide.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? When you have to take your car into the shop, look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE blue seal of excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
A
Hi, this is Carl Edwards here for RAD, the entertainment industry's voice for road safety. You want to make a difference? It's simple. Be responsible. Plan ahead. Designate before you celebrate. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Final segment for the evening, but still some things to talk about here. First of all, though, going to get to our forecasted. Always like to have some fun with this. We're calling it the Bunky Challenge, and if you're a regular listener to the show, then you understand where that comes from. We have a commercial that runs during the show, which our one of our producers, Bob Steele, we got Big Mike behind the glass here tonight doing such a capable job for us, keeping us on track, but one of the the producers at PMM, Bob Steele, came up with the name Bunky, and we just sort of adopted it. So Bunky is now the official show mascot. We are doing the Bunky Challenge. All of us at Race Chaser Online just throwing around our picks each weekend for the NASCAR stuff. And you know what? I'm going to let Jacob Seelman actually introduce this, because Jacob, you have a better idea of who's where. The only thing I'm going to do, though, is before I throw it to you, I'm going to start. And the reason I'm going to do that is because I know I didn't have a good weekend this weekend. I got to be last.
Who did you pick? Who did you have for the cup race? You had a Penske car.
I had Keselowski for the cup race, and I had Regan Smith for the Xfinity race. So that I
didn't have. Kyle Magda swept the weekend.
Well, Kyle, we'll get to Kyle in a minute.
Tom. One of the five of us had Joey Logano, who actually was the worst of all our picks. So whoever had Joey Logano needs to raise their hand and go first.
Raise your hand. I had a feeling that in picking Logano for the cup race, I was probably going to get burned. And I suppose I was burned. So, if you must lead, I believe we're doing Xfinity, Sprint Cup, and IndyCar?
Yes, sir.
Oh, wow. Okay. I think since we have Toyota sponsorship, I will give them a tip of the cap in at least one of those. And I'll say that since I believe Eric Jones is racing, I haven't found the entry list for this weekend's Xfinity race yet, but we'll take Eric Jones in that race, especially since Toyotas tend to have a pretty good record. And Joe Gibbs tends to have a pretty good record at this track. And then, let's see, Sprint Cup. There's a large part of me that wants to go Denny Hamlin at his home track. And I think I will, and if I have to switch picks because his back spasms keep him out, then I'll just do that via Facebook before the race starts. So I'll go with Hamlin for now. And then in IndyCar, because I get to be first to pick, and because you're crazy if you don't pick him on a road course first, I want willpower, and willpower all the way. He's pretty good at Barber, too. There's also that small part of it. So let me have those three drivers for this week, and then I'll let Jacob handle the rest of this. You master of ceremonies, you.
Oh, thank you, James. Okay, so we got that out of the way. Then next up is Kevin Harvick, who was the worst of the rest, and nobody actually picked him over the weekend. So then that brings us to the one and only Blue Deuce, which it killed two people, Tom. It killed you and it killed me. But since I have more points than you, you have to go first.
Yeah, I'm not even close, I don't think, at this point. But
no, you're not.
And, you know, I really want to pick a NASCAR Cup driver to win the Xfinity Series at Richmond this weekend, since that is usually what happens. Every once in a while, you get an exception. But the problem is we don't have the entry list yet, so I'm not sure who's in what car. So I'm going to have to think about this a little bit. And, you know, the whole problem with Xfinity right now is that you basically have
The 22 car, whoever drives that is usually up front contending for the win. You also have the 18 car, from the Gibbs stable, and the 20 car that both seem to run very well. 54 car's been off for the most part. New team over there, and definitely hasn't been as up to snuff, so to speak. So I'm going to have to, you know what? I'm going to try something a little different. I'm going to pick Ty Dillon this weekend to get the win in the Xfinity Series race. And I'll go with that for the Cup race. This popped into my mind earlier this afternoon, and I'm not sure, and I'm going to have to temper this by saying I don't know if he's going to be in the field because we haven't heard anything, but until I hear something different, Denny Hamlin gets it done in the Cup race. IndyCar, you know what? I'm going to stick with the same pick I had last week because I still think it's just I like Juan Pablo Montoya, and I like his chances at a run for the championship this year. So we'll go with Juan Pablo Montoya or John Paul Montana, depending on whether you want the American or Spanish version. But I'll pick him in the IndyCar series.
Fair enough.
Well, I guess Kyle Magda swept the weekend. I get to insert my picks here. And, you know, I noticed with the last couple guys that picked here, no stats to back up any of your picks. I mean, you guys must see something pretty clear in that crystal ball, but... I know that Kyle's the stat man, so I'm going to have to blow out the stat book to follow up what he's going to say here in a few minutes for his pick. So in the Xfinity Series, a strong run at Bristol. He's got two straight top tens at Richmond. He's had three career starts here, four top fives in seven races this season. Let's just say that Chris Buescher is riding the momentum wave, and that wave's going to carry him and wash him right into victory lane at Richmond on Friday night. As for IndyCar, five straight podium finishes at Barber, coming off the win in Long Beach. He has momentum. Same deal with Chris Buescher. That momentum wave's going to carry him right into victory lane. That's Scott Dixon for the IndyCar series. And for the Cup Series, this is a little bit of a long shot, but I've made it known that I'm not gonna go right straight to the winner. I want a guy that's gonna give me a consistent top 10 finish to contend up for the points in our fantasy league. And after Carl Edwards was up there last week for me, finished 24th after the wreck, but this guy won here in 2003. He finished eighth in this race last season, and he's never had a DNF year, and that's so crucial. I know he's not with crew chief Luke Lambert, but Ryan Newman is going to victory lane this weekend. He might go to victory lane. I hope he does, but I'm certainly believing that he's going to be a top 10 contender, and that's why Newman's going to get me some points this week. So with that being said, we turn to Kyle Magda, who swept the weekend, and Bunky was proud of you.
Yeah, hold the applause, guys. Thank you. I appreciate it. But yeah, I got the broom out this weekend, and like Marshall said, I'm like Kyle Busch, so I'll take my bow. Thank you. This weekend, we got three races this weekend, too. Richmond won it at Barber. Looking over the entry list here, there is one guy that you did miss for the Xfinity race who is running this weekend, and that is also the hometown boy as well, Denny Hamlin, if he runs in the back spasm, or not the back spasm, the neck spasm. You guys could probably help me out with that. He winds up running the 20 car. I will take Denny Hamlin. Not, like I said, we'll just Facebook message it. And for Saturday's race, I've been kicking this pick around a lot. I had Matt Kenseth last week, and I will say that the JGR short track dominance does continue. But, like Marshall picked last week, I'm going to go with Carl Edwards this week. You know, had a really strong run at Bristol, except for the end there, and I don't know what's going to happen. And then for the IndyCar race, this is what I'm going to do. Okay, this driver, I'm going to pick. I don't know whether they're going to run or not, but this driver winds up running. I'm going to pick Simona DiSilvestro. She winds up running the race. Don't know whether she will or not, but that's who I'm going to take. She had a good run at New Orleans last week. And if not, if she does not run, I am going to take Elio Castroneves. So Simona runs. I'll take her. Not I'll take Elio Castroneves. So,
wow,
Jacob, that's what do you got for us?
That's fair. I'm very surprised by that, Kyle, and actually a little bit impressed because Simona has always been very good at Barber. Of course, Elio's been very good at Barber too, so that's really not surprising. But anyway, okay, I deferred my place in line to go last just because. So here's the deal, and I'm going to make this very short, very sweet, very simple. Kyle Magda, do you still have the entry list for the Xfinity race?
You know what? It's not even out on NASCAR media yet.
I'm sad. I'm very sad. But you know what? I have a gut instinct about this weekend because there's one track that the normal driver of the number 88 doesn't like, and that's Richmond. So I doubt Dale Earnhardt Jr. is going to be behind the wheel of that car this week, which would leave one driver, Kevin Harvick. I'm going to go ahead and change what I originally wrote in my notes, and I'm going to take the 88 this weekend for the Xfinity race because I have a feeling Harvick's in it. If Harvick's in it, he's got a shot to win it. So I'll go with the 88 for the Xfinity race. For the Cup race, no, heck, why not? I'm going to do it again because after finishing 37th, he can certainly – or no, not 37th, 39th. I'm getting my numbers screwed up. He can certainly do better than that. He bounces back from having the top 10 streak broken with a win. I'll just take Harvick for the whole weekend and be done with that. IndyCar, I picked before Senior Marshall probably read my pick and took it, but I'm going to stick right with it. Team Target, Scott Dixon. He's awful good at a place that's similar to Barber, Mid-Ohio. He went from last to win there last August, and I say he continues and gets career win number 37. I like Team Target, and I'm on pace as far as a fourth IndyCar championship. I think Joel's a little torn on that one yet, but I say Dixon's going to win the championship before it's all said and done. That Team Tom looks really, 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 really good right now.
That's a lot of reallys, and with that, we're really going to throw the checkered flag on this 2 hours of motorsports conversation. So for Marshall Gabel, for James Pike, for Kyle Magda, for Jacob Seelman, and for Hunter Smith and Joel Sebastianelli as well, our entire RaceChaserOnline.com crew, along with Big Mike behind the glass tonight, we invite you all and hope that you all will keep it off the wall. Until we meet again, we'll see you at the racetrack. Good night, everybody. Have a great week.
You've been listening to Motorsports Madness with the Speed 77 Radio Race Chaser Online crew. Stay tuned to Performance Motorsports Network for more race talk. For the latest motorsports news, visit RaceChaserOnline.com. Motorsports Madness is a copyrighted production of the Performance Motorsports Network. www.performancemotorsportsnetwork.com, a member of the Scorpion Radio Group, Inc., and may not be rebroadcast, replicated, or saved in any media without the explicit written permission of PMN. Check out our Facebook page or our section on the PMN website. The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host, co-host, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of the management and ownership of either the Performance Motorsports Network or Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated, the advertisers, or the marketing partners. Be listening again next week when the madness returns on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Until then, keep it off the wall and keep the shiny side up.